Good afternoon, dear colleague. Thank you very much, first of all, to be here at my webinar. I'm Dr. Rossi and I'm speaking to you from Milan. I'm an oral surgeon and my principal field of interest is oral surgery and implant dentistry. The topic of my presentation of this afternoon is the treatment of the alveolar socket after tooth extraction. And I think that it's very important to understand what we know nowadays about this type of surgery. In particular, I would like to share with you some aspect regarding socket sealing. In particular, I would like to share with you the history and why we are speaking today about socket sealing. Second, indication to socket sealing, basic principle of this type of surgery, then the surgical technique, and then survival and success of this type of surgery. Starting so from the history, we know that if we take a look to the literature and we go to see in the paper of at least 20 years ago, we can find any publication regarding socket sealing, but all the publication regard implant placed into extraction socket. So in that year, what we made normally and what was also suggested, for example, in this publication, was to insert an implant where we remove a tooth. So, for example, in this publication, you may see that the conclusion of Chen and co-authors was very interesting because they concluded that short-term survival rates and clinical outcome of immediate and delayed implant were similar and were comparable to those of implant placed into iliac alveolar ridge. So, what we made from the beginning of the 20th century, 21st century, was to treat this patient with a post-extracting implant. Here you may see a young lady with a problem to the upper incisor. At the beginning, with the orthodontist, we thought to make a surgical treatment in order to use the orthodontic device to restore the tooth, but this was not possible because the decay was completely interested into the socket, into the tooth. So, if we look at the X-ray, we may see that we have enough bone for an implant. And if we look on our diagnostic tool, we may see that we have good condition. And we decided to restore immediately the left upper incisor. So, what we made was the extraction of the tooth. Then, after tooth extraction, we use a surgical guide in order to insert the implant in the right position. I think that in this type of surgery, it's really very important the use of a surgical guide. And then, using the guide, we start to prepare our implant site. Here, the first drill. Then, I normally always check the position of my implant during site preparation. Then, another phase of the preparation of the implant site. We continue to prepare the site and we verify with the last pin the right position, not only in the frontal vision, but also very important in the palatal vision in order to verify that the position of our implant will be palatal and not too near to the bone that we have on the buccal part. And then I inserted an implant of 12 millimeter, a bone level implant. Here are the phases in which I have inserted the implant, and this at the end of the position of the implant into the alveolar socket. Then we have to evaluate the gap that we have between the buccal bone and the implant, and in this case, we measure this gap and we decided to fill anything between the bone and the implant. So, in this case, we prefer and we decided with my prosthodontist, Dr. Diego Lopes, to have a transmucosal healing in order to have an immediate restoration. And so at the end of the surgery, of my surgery, the patient was in this condition. Then the prosthodontist start to prepare the provisional crown. Here you have the radiographic control of the implant insertion. And then the EagleOps start the prosthetic phases in order to give a dental provisional crown to our patient. Here, what we made. Here, the maturation of the C tissue after 6 months, and then the final restoration with this type of result. As you may see, we have a brilliant result with a good position of our soft tissue. And normally, when we have a stable soft tissue, as you may see with my pointer around our crown, we have also hard tissue in the right position. Sorry, but here there was an X-ray that I don't see. So, what's happened? What's happened about socket sealing? Happened that after less than 4 or 5 years to the previous publication, we start to find in the literature some new papers regarding what happened to the extraction site. And for example, in this publication, it's very interesting the conclusion. We have not long-term data in order to say that this type of procedure may be predictable, in particular in aesthetic areas. And if you look also to other papers present in the literature, this group published two papers, in my opinion, very important. In this 4-1 publication, they say that the study demonstrated that the removal of the single teeth and the immediate placement of an implant resulted in a marked alteration of the dimension of the buccal ridge and the horizontal as well as the vertical gap between the implant and the bony walls. So, if you consider also the next publication that was done from the same group, we may see how the researcher consider and alert the clinician in order to consider very well the condition of the alveolar socket and when inserting implant after tooth extraction. So, if we go to the, for example, to the conclusion of the last osteology consensus report, we may see that this is now the direction of the researcher because I don't want to read with you all this slide, but very important is the conclusion in which the authors underline that in the aesthetic zone, however, a higher risk of foramucosal recession was reported. So we have to consider very well if we have to do a post-extractive implant in the anterior region. For this region zone, we start to speak about socket sealing. And we start to speak about socket sealing with which indication? The same indication that we have in the past for the post-extractive implant. So, if we want to use this type of classification, that for me is a very good classification for a clinician, we have to use this technique when we are in class 1 of Ammer and Young, or if you prefer to use another type of classification, we may use the classification made by Kevood and Howell, and the indication to use this type of surgery is the class 2 of Kevood and Howell. We have also to focus our attention not only on the socket sealing that in my slide I have inserted with the green lamp, but we have to consider very well also other parameters like the medical history of the patient, the extra and intraoral examination, the evaluation of this hard and soft tissue before starting a socket sealing procedure. It's really very important to understand which type of patient we have to treat. It's really important to evaluate the hard tissue. In particular, we have to evaluate the size of the defect and which type of defect we have at the bony wall of our alveolar socket. Also very important, the evaluation of soft tissue, not only from the periodontal point of view, but also we have to verify the absence of scar tissue that may compromise the success of our. So, when we started to use this technique, we know that we have some publication regarding this type of surgical approach. In particular, I think that one important publication was this publication of Jung of about 12 years ago, but also the publication of Araújo was very important. Then we have many other publications regarding this type of surgery. In particular, I would like to focus your attention on these two publications, because in the first publication, Jung evaluated 40 patients divided into four different groups, treated with four different materials inserted in the alveolar socket. In one case, in one group, beta-calcium phosphate. In the second, demineralized bovine bone covered by a collagen matrix. In the third group, demineralized bovine bone covered with autogenous soft tissue graft, and then spontaneous healing. Then he made a cone beam at 6 months. And what he saw that in all the cases we had a ridge reduction, so we have a change in the width of the crest, but the best result was obtained when we use the deproteinized bone into the socket. And if we take a look to the other publication made by the Araújo, the result that we obtain are very similar. The study that he made is quite different because he analyzed 28 subjects with maxillary incisors of canines that have to be extracted. And then he divided into two groups, one test group with bios collagen into the socket, the control group with no graft. After 4 months, he made CBCT in order to evaluate the ridge alteration. And what he saw the same that was seen before by Jung. So we had a ridge which changes, and we have less resorption if we use a material inside the alveolar socket. So I think that if we consider only this publication, we made a little mistake because this publication analyzed only radiographic results, but we have also to understand, because we are clinicians, what happened from a clinical point of view. And if we look to the latest publication regarding the alveolar ridge preservation, for example, this publication that was made by the Cochrane collaboration, we may see that the conclusion that they reported in this paper of the last year are very interesting. There is a limited evidence that our technique may minimize the overall change in residual ridge height and width 6 months after surgery. So, from this publication and from other publication, is very interesting to evaluate what they tell to us, because they are saying that if we want to conserve soft tissue and also hard tissue, this type of technique may not be so predictable. And if you look to other two papers regarding post-extraction site, we may see that, for example, in this fourth publication, the conclusion is that a certain degree of ridge volume loss should be expected, even if ARP, alveolar ridge preservation, is applied, and also in this publication, the conclusion are very similar because it's reported by the author that the resorption of the alveolar ridge cannot be stopped totally by a HARP alveolar ridge preservation. So, if you want to define when we use and when we can use the alveolar socket sealing, I think that this publication may be the more useful for us that are clinician and that normally do implant dentistry. Because the authors of this important publication say that application of ARP reduced the amount of volume resorption compared to spontaneous healing and seems to help the buccal soft tissue contour. But if we analyze hard tissue, we may see what they say in their publication. For a 100% preservation of the tissue contour, a flap elevation and an augmentation procedure to the buccal aspect of the alveolar ridge needs to be considered. So, what can be concluded? That we may use the socket sealing technique in the static zone in order to maintain or increase soft tissue volume. We are not sure that this technique is good also on the hard tissue. And as you may see in these two slides, in these two images, we may use this type of technique in two very different situations. One, that is situation A, when we have to do socket sealing with immediate insertion of an implant. B, when we have to do only socket sealing. Now we will start to see the surgical treatment starting from the class A. In this case, we have to analyze two important aspects, very, very important, because if we don't analyze these two aspects, we have a very high risk of soft tissue defects. In particular, we have to focus our attention on the integrity of the buccal wall of the alveolar socket and to have good facial bone thickness. In particular, regarding good facial bone thickness, there is a publication that was made by an important group of researchers in which the authors analyzed what happened in this post-extraction site with a CBCT. And what they say is really very important because they have seen that there is a correlation between the thickness of the facial bone wall and the extent of the bone resorption of the buccal alveolar plate. In particular, if you look to the conclusion, the thin wall phenotypes display the pronounced vertical bone resorption with a median bone loss of 7.5 mm as compared with thick wall phenotype, which decreased by only 1.1 mm. So we can use this type of surgery, so socket sealing and implant placement, only when we have a thickness of the bony walls that is not less than 1 millimeter. In this case, our treatment may be predictable. So let me show you a case of this type of surgery. Here we have a patient with a problem at this lower canine. You may see that there is something in this X-ray, but in the next slide you may understand well which was the problem of this canine. What we made is the extraction of the tooth. We have very good healthy tissue around our tooth, you may see here. Then, after tooth extraction, you may see which was the problem of this teeth with a very big decay of the root. And so, we continue to treat our patient, checking the width of the buccal plate, then we have inserted a standard plus implant, here the preparation of the implant site, then as in the case before we have to verify very well the position of our implant after site preparation, here the insertion of the implant, and very, very important, you may see here that we have a very thick bony wall that is very important to have a brilliant result at the end of the treatment. We decided to insert in this gap biomaterial, and then, sorry, but there is not the most important slide, that is a slide in which we have used our membrane. You may see the radiographic control after implant insertion, and you may see that we have closed the socket using a barrier that is a xenogenic barrier from porcelain. And this at the end of the surgery, this 8 weeks later. What you may see is that we have a very good healthy soft tissue that are really very important in an aesthetic area, and we have recreated soft tissue also where we put our barrier exposed into the oral cavity. So after 5 months, we make the reopening of the implant, then another radiographic control, and then the final restoration of this patient with the diastema in this area. But we decided to do this diastema because if you look from an occlusal point of view, we may see that on the other side there is the same diastema, and so with the patient we decided to do the same also on the side of the implant. And if we focus our attention on the convexity of the soft tissue, I think that we have reached a very good result because we have normal tissue around our dental crown and our implant. And if we check also how hard tissue and where are hard tissue around our implant, we may see that the result is quite good because we have no resorption around our tissue level implants. So this was the treatment of the socket ceiling when we decided to insert an implant. But when we can't insert an implant, we may do the same technique with some difference. As we have seen before, it's really very important to analyze the thickness of this part of the residual bone, and it's also very important to erase the flap only to see the margin of the bone. It's not necessary to make very big flaps in order to see all the bone on the buccal aspect. And so, look to another case. This is a lady with a problem to this incisor. I would like that you focus your attention to the tissue, soft tissue around its tooth, and the position, the apical position of this tooth. So, this is the occlusal situation of the patient and the radiographic that show that we have to extract this upper incisor. So we extract the tooth, we have this situation after tooth extraction. Then we insert bovine bone into the alveolar socket in order to reduce the resorption of the bone into the socket. Here at the end of the filling of the material, and then we prepare our matrix. Very, very important, as I have written here, you have to maintain the membrane into saline solution or into the blood of the patient for at least 10 minutes, and then after 10 minutes we can customize our barrier, and then we have to insert our barrier. It's very, very important to understand how to insert the barrier, but I would like to show you this aspect during a film, a video that we made after. So, this was the situation after the position of the xenogenic membranes. Then, single stitches in order to close the papilla, and here you may see that we left our xenogenic barrier completely exposed into the oral cavity. And what's happened? After 4 weeks, this is the situation from a frontal point of view and also from an occlusal point of view. You may see here that we have a little problem due to the temporary crown that the patient used, that was a removable crown and made this type of problem on the soft tissue. But if you take a look after 20 weeks, the situation was really changed. We have a good, stable soft tissue. And for me, it's very interesting to compare from where we started to where we arrived. You understand very well that in this situation, we can insert an implant, reducing the risk of recession of soft tissue, And if we have inserted an implant in this type of condition, I think that the risk of having some anesthetic result may be very, very high. So, in other cases regarding this type of technique that I have made with my friend and prosthodontist Diego Lopes, a young lady with a problem at this upper incisor, we analyzed the situation from an occlusal point of view also. We have a very good healthy soft tissue also on the buccal part of the maxilla, but the problem in this patient was not on the buccal part, on the or at the buccal wall of this incisor, but was here on the palatal aspect. We have a very great probing in this area. So we decided to extract the tooth and to treat the patient with a socket sealing procedure. What we made, very, very simple. We have only to separate soft tissue from the teeth that we have to extract. Then tooth extraction. Then we have to analyze very well the thickness of the bone. We may see here which is the thickness of the bone in this upper incisor. And so, in my opinion, it's not suggested to do a post-extractive implant in this situation. We have also to analyze that probably we will have a contraction of the bone in this area. And so we decided to do a socket sealing procedure. So we prepare our mucoderm. We customize the mucoderm in order to have the closure of the alveolar socket. And then we inserted the mucoderm under the flap on the palatal side. Then we inserted biomaterial in order to give, in order to reduce the risk of resorption at the alveolar socket, and then we close our barrier and we put our mucoderm under the flap, a full thickness flap in this situation, here at the end of the surgery. Please focus your attention on the exposed area of the mucoderm. And this what's happened after 6 weeks. The patient have a provisional crown, a Maryland attached to the nearest tooth, but you may see that we have very good convexity of the soft tissue on the buccal aspect. And now, regarding this patient, I would like to show you a film that may be very useful to understand how to do this procedure. We obviously starting with the anesthesia, then we have to separate soft tissue from the tooth, starting with the blade. We have to be very gentle and very kind with our soft tissue. Now we do the periotomy of the tissue on the buccal and palatal aspect. And then tooth extraction. We have to be very careful because we don't have to damage the alveolar bony walls. We extract the tooth. And now, very important, we check if we have bone in the right position. You may see that the papilla are conserved. Also, the buccal palatal bone is good. The problem is only on the palatal aspect of this patient. So we prepare the flaps in order to receive our membrane, we make a full thickness flap. This is a very important phase of our surgery. We have to do this type of flap elevation also on the palatal aspect. And then, when we have prepared, we customize the mucoderm, our collagen membrane matrix, sorry. The matrix, as you may see, it's very, very wet. And then we insert first under the palatal flap. And now I will show you how to insert this barrier under the buccal flap. You have to be very, very careful and very, very gentle with the soft tissue. So we insert our barrier. And then stitches in order to have the closure. And then we insert an implant in this area. And the prosthodontist, Dr. Diego Lopes, made the prosthetic evaluation in order to have a good final aesthetic result. But what is for me more important is to underline that we have recreated a normal soft tissue contour around our tissue, around our implant, and we are around our crown. And if we compare from where we start in this image to the result that we have obtained, and we are in this case at the temporary crown, not at the final restoration, I think that we have a very good result because the soft tissue are in the correct position, and I think that we will not have any type of problem in the final restoration of this patient. So now let me analyze the success and what we have seen regarding this material. I would like to show you the result that my friend and colleague Deb Palombo showed at the last periodontal congress that we have in Italy, regarding healing of potential of the new xenogenic collagen matrix in post-extractive socket. These are preliminary results, but I think that are really very interesting. The aim of our research was to evaluate this barrier in order to understand which type of wound closure we may have when we use this type of material. The aesthetic result, we have used this barrier in many, many cases for the treatment of the aesthetic area. And in some cases, we have also done the histological analysis of the soft tissue of the area that we treated with the Mucoderm. We treated 10 patients, 4 males and 6 females, that needed the extraction of a single tooth, so we extract only one tooth with the problem or perio or endo. We made the atraumatic removal of the tooth, and then we made the socket preservation with or with an immediate submerged implant. So in 5 cases, we make socket preservation. In other 5 cases, we made socket preservation with an immediate submerged implant. We insert BIOS collagen as filling material into the alveolar socket, and we try to use the Mucoderm in this way. Two-thirds of the surface stabilized under the palatal and buccal gingival margin, one-third exposed for a second healing intention. So a part of the mucosa have to stay open to the oral cavity. Then, another case that was included in our research a female with a problem to a premolar in the lower arch, you may see that these tooth have great root resorption. So we decided to extract the tooth that was not in good condition. Then we prepare our matrix using saline solution and blood of the patient, probably the best way to hydrate this type of membrane is the blood of the patient. After 5 to 10 minutes, we have this condition of our mucoden that have to be completely wet, and then the alveolar socket on the left side of the slide. We decided to cover the alveolar socket with our mucoden. We customize the mucoden in this way, and we know that only one third of the mucoden should be exposed to the oral cavity. We fill the burning materials into the alveolar socket, and then we close our mucoden, inserting this side under the buccal flap and the other side under the lingual flap. This the situation at the end of the surgery. You may see two single stitches and the mucoderm exposed to the oral cavity. And this what we found after 8 weeks. You may see very good stable soft tissue, not different from soft tissue that we have near to the other tooth. And so, after 6 months, we made a CT scan in order to evaluate the quality of the bone in which we have to insert our implant. Then we erase the flap. You may see the quality of the bone that we found after 6 months. And so, using a surgical guide, we start to prepare the implant site. Here, the first drill, the second and the third drill. Then we verify the position of our implant site preparation, the width of our implant site preparation, and then we insert an implant of 10 millimeter in the proper position. This is the last drill in order to prepare the most coronal part of the implant site, and then stitches on the flap and the radiographic control after the position of the implant. And what we analyzed? We analyzed the exposed surface of the matrix at the end of the surgery, then the soft tissue healing after 1, 4, 6, and 8 weeks from surgery. Then we evaluated the aesthetic score between the regenerated site and the surrounding gingiva 8 weeks after surgery. And then, in 5 cases, during the implant reopening, we have also done an histological analysis of the soft tissue that we have recreated. Starting from the area of exposure, we have seen that the mean postoperative exposure area was 26 millimeters squared. This is very important, but it's also very important to underline another important thing, that after 8 weeks after surgery, full wound closure was achieved in 9 of the 10 sites. Only in one case, that is the patient 3, that is in this column, didn't reach the complete healing of the area. You may see what happened in this patient in this little image, because we have a problem due probably to the fact that the we have a very highest post-operative matrix exposure in this case. You may see that more than a third of the membrane was left opened, and so probably this type of exposure was the real problem that gave this type of results. And if we look to other results, for example, the aesthetic score that we have, we may see that in 7 of the 10 patients, the aesthetic integration, as you may read here, was quite perfect. In 2 patients, we have a good integration with the delta E very, very good. Only in the case in which we have the not complete healing of our barrier, we have a result that is not good at the aesthetic evaluation. Then, from an histological point of view, it's very interesting to see that the histological evaluation of the gingiva take at the time 5 reveal the presence of healthy keratinized gingival tissue with no sign of aberration and anomalies. And so the conclusion of this preliminary paper are for us that we have a very good result with this new xenogenic porcine-derived collagen matrix for having a good healing in the post-extractive socket, in particular in the aesthetic areas. Obviously, that we need more data regarding this type of material in order to understand which are the real possibility of this barrier. So, in conclusion to my presentation, what we have seen together is that the socket sealing is indicated when we have class 1 or 2 of MLE, when we have a good buccal bony wall, and when we want to maintain and increase soft tissue. We are not so sure that this type of surgery may be useful in the maintenance of the hard tissue. For the indication, what we have seen that we may have advantages in using this type of surgery because we have a first intention healing of the alveolar socket, and we have a barrier that is able to protect an implant and/or the biomaterials that we use with or without the implant. And another important advantages of this type of surgery, and we may have a good result without any type of release incision that we know that are a problem because they may be one of the causes of edema after surgery. And very, very important, we don't have the alteration of the mucogingival line that we have normally when we do normal surgery, normal surgery with regeneration in order to have a first healing closure, like in this case, in which we have, yes, a good sealing with the stitches of our flaps, but we have the alteration of this mucogingival line that in some cases may be a problem in order to have brilliant aesthetic result and good keratinized soft tissue around our implant and around our tooth. So really thank you very much for your kind attention to my presentation. Thank you very much really to everyone, and if you have any question to make to myself, I will appreciate every type of questions. In your first case, what was discussed in regard to the delayed eruption condition? But sorry, Ziva, I don't understand. My first case regarding the young lady with the upper incisor with the great decay of the tooth? Or you? Ah, okay. Because you have seen that she had teeth, tooth very, very short, you have seen. Is correct. because with those, so the prostodontis, we didn't found any alteration in the eruption condition. Yes, for the patient, the aesthetic first, I try to give an answer to Ziv Simon. I have discussed with this patient regarding the crown lengthening, but when we see the patient, she was, if I remember well, 25. And this was the condition in which the lady was from not many, but some years. So the problem of the dimension of the crown was for me. For the patient and also the prostodontist, not so relevant. So we decided to treat the patient with this type of crown that it's correctly a short crown, not a very big crown. Okay, I would like to give an answer to Khaled Smeo. I hope to have a good pronunciation of your name. The question is, after 6 months after socket sealing, an implant can be loaded? In my opinion, yes. What we made normally, as you have seen in my presentation, is to check very well the condition of the alveolar socket, in particular the thickness of the bony wall, of the buccal wall is the most important. If we have good condition at the beginning, we can insert the implant, we can fill the gap with the biomaterial, and then, as in regenerative surgery, we wait 6 months only because we wait that the biomaterial and also the implant have to reach an integration. So I normally load my implant after 6 months, also if they are post-extractive implant. But it's very important the evaluation that I made or with the sit-in before surgery, with the CT before surgery, or during the surgery. Do you understand, Smeo? Very interesting question from Chi Hong Tang. I think that my spelling is not correct of your name, but I try to give a response to you. Regarding the parodontal biotype, it's very interesting this question because he asked me almost all of the cases you shown were with thick biotype. If you encounter with patient with thin biotype, do you still perform the same approach? I think that it's quite interesting to analyze the type of the gingival biotype that we found in our patient. And I think that if we have a thin biotype, probably I try to avoid the immediate implant placement. I prefer to treat first the alveolar socket and then after the maturation of the soft tissue, I made an implant. Because, as we know very well from literature, in this patient, the risk of a soft tissue recession is really very high. So I think that we have to be very, very afraid, we have to be very careful in this case, and we have to treat this patient step by step, first at the soft tissue levels and then at the hard tissue level or inserting an implant. Okay, there is another question made by Nuria Nogueron, and she asked me which type of provisional restoration I made in my patient. I normally prefer to use a provisional that have not to compress the area of the mucoderm. As you have seen in one of my cases, in one case we have a little problem to the soft tissue due to the temporary restoration. And normally I try to use the Maryland in order to reduce the risk of compression of the mucoderm. Okay, there is another question made by Ziv Simon. What is your opinion about using growth factor like BMP, PRP, PRF? I have to tell you that my experience regarding this type of material is reduced. We try to use in the university PRP. And we have seen that this is very good for the soft tissue healing, but regarding the other material, I cannot tell you anything because I have no experience. I would like only to ask to Chihorn Tang, if this is correct name, if my answer was good, because it's very important the evaluation of the biotype of the patient. Okay, thank you. So, dear colleague, really thank you very much for your participation to my webinar, and I hope that this may be useful for you and your clinical practice. Thank you very much. Thank you very nice. Thank you very much, and have a nice evening. Bye.